Welcome to a time of worship here in Sharon, Vermont, at the Congregational Church. I invite you to center yourself for worship. I invite you to breathe in and to breathe out. When you breathe in, think Jesus. And then as you breathe out, think first Jesus, then loves, and then me. Let us center. I invite you to be at worship, not just watching the performance, not just watching to see if this is going to look like worship and not a terrorist's capture video. I invite you to find that place where God is with you and to worship. Worship the Lord our God with all the people of earth and in heaven. It was on the night that Jesus knew he was to die, and he was with his disciples, dearest of people to him, that he said to them, "Peace, peace be with you. Not as the world gives do I give to you, but my peace I give to you." And so we light the peace candle to always remember. May peace be with you. Let us pray the Lord's Prayer together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." So straight to something else that makes worship in this congregation unique and special. Spirit sightings, those times and ways that we are aware of God, that we're thankful for God, and we want to praise, be gracious. And I have to say that if you're watching this, you are currently a spirit sighting for me. This is not always an easy thing to do, you know, trying out technology and working on how to do this and watching. It's weird. And Jim, if you are at home in your pajamas, good for you. Because we should be relaxed and we should be with God and aware that God doesn't really care if we've got on our Sunday best, especially if we're still home. And if Sunny or others are at home enjoying a nice cup of coffee while they're being at worship, again, good job. But you're here, and that means a lot to me. It means a lot because pastors are always trying to figure out if what they're doing has any value, if people are responding, if it's good enough, let alone good. The fact that you are here, that you're watching, is a spirit sighting for me, and I thank you for that. Now, if you have other spirit sightings, I'm pretty sure that down below there's a comment section. And if you'd like to lift up or actually write down where you have sensed God's presence of late, that would be a very cool thing for you to do. So, the scripture lesson, and if you're wondering, no, I'm not sticking with a lectionary. We're giving that up for Lent. What I've selected after the advice of my wife is from Jeremiah chapter 29. It is a letter that Jeremiah, who is still in Jerusalem, sends as a prophet of God to the people in Babylon. And he sends it to the elders and to everybody else because they're in exile. Babylon has picked them up and carried them away, and they're in exile. They don't like it very much. But this is what Jeremiah says to them for God. For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then, when you call upon me and come and pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I will let you find me, says the Lord. And I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. Because you have said, the Lord has raised up prophets for us in Babylon. That ends the reading. Okay, Jeremiah. Jeremiah, if you don't know, he could be a remarkably grumpy, angry prophet. And he really, when he wanted to lay into the people and to the priests and everybody else, he could really lay into them. But that's not the prophet's only job. The prophet not only speaks to the people for God. Oh, well, that's what he's doing here. It's not the other way around. He is speaking to the people for God, and he is trying to tell them, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. Not good, not easy, maybe unpleasant, but it will be okay. He starts off by saying, I know what my plans are for you. It's a great way of saying, the current situation is in my hands. I know what's happening. And it has an end. I don't know about you. I am already beginning to look for an end to this. You need to stay home. You need to keep distance from everybody. You need to live a life that is completely non-normal. I'm ready for that to end. And this is trying to tell us it will end. Please hear that. It will end. But Jeremiah goes on a little bit farther and says, I hold this in my hand. I hold you in my hand. And that is important to remember, whatever the situation. Whether we're walking in the woods on a beautiful sunny day, or if we're walking in the damp gray, or whether we're sitting at home for day 8, we are in God's hand. Now, with the Old Testament theology, we have this understanding that God caused this exile to happen. A more progressive idea is that the people's idolatry meant that this was bound to happen, and indeed has. But the idea that we and this situation is in God's hands means that God will not be pulling out a miracle and ending it magically. God doesn't do magic. So we have this word of hope, and we have that it's going to end, and that God is still with us. But I want you to hear a little bit more. I want you to hear the God that Jeremiah loves and follows and speaks for. This is a great God. It's my God. It's how I understand God. It is my hope that you're able to hear in these words the God that Jeremiah knows. God has this in hand. This exile for the Israel is bad. It makes them feel vulnerable and tentative and scared and worried and all of these really hard emotions. And God says, look, I know you're in exile, and I know why you are in exile, but you're still mine. I still love you. And here is my message to you in the midst of all of that. My love is such that I still send a message of hope. Down through the centuries, people have heard that sense of hope in this portion of Jeremiah, and they keep passing it down to us. And when I say to us, I mean to you and to me and to everybody. Hold that. That's a God worth following. That is an amazing God. And even though there is hope that it will end, and even though God is with us and is doing all these good things for us, you need to know that God's love is such that God is still in touch. I also want you to notice something else that apparently Jeremiah is aware of. He ends what I read by saying, this is because you sense that I'm still active. You believe that I'm still having prophets and still sending you prophets, even though you're in Babylon. It's as if God says, hey, if you think I'm active, I'm going to be active. If you have trust in me to send you messages, I'm going to send you messages. And if you still believe and want to hear from me, I am touched. I am your God. You are my people. This is a really amazing message, that just because that's what we want and feel we need, God loves us, even in exile, even in separation, even in lockdown, even in whatever pandemic we're in, God still loves us, is still seeking ways to care for us, still sending messages that say, as best as possible, I love you. I care about you. Watching over you, this will come to an end. That's the God I'm constantly trying to preach, that I really want you to know and to trust and to love. And one of the best ways of doing that right now is doing what they did in Babylon, talking to God. assuring God that you look to God, that you have some sense that God's message is coming to you. Be it spirit sightings, be it in prayers, whatever. Keep talking with God. God loves you. You might as well let God know that you love back. Amen. As we come to a time of prayer, I invite you to be in a spirit of prayer. And if you are aware of prayer needs, requests, joys, celebrations, you should be able to put them down below in that comment section. Just say prayer request and list it. And if you have a need or a request that isn't a prayer, there are ways of getting some of these practical needs met as well. And if you don't know how, please be in touch with me and we'll go from there. But for now, let us be together in the spirit of prayer. Lord, you are our God. We are your people. We look to you for our souls, our hope, our calm, our way through exiles, separations, distances, abandonment. We are grateful for medicine, for to them we look for our physical help and well-being. We are grateful to our leaders who organize and create a way forward in the midst of chaos, in the midst of our fear. Thank you. Lord, we pray for the safety of family and friends, medical personnel, and first responders. We pray also for us, but we especially pray for those who are lacking. We pray for the homeless and others who will not have a place if they must shelter in place. Those without medical insurance to pay for even basics. We pray for those who need surgery, procedures, and care unrelated to a pandemic. We pray for light, for those who travel life in the dark with nothing but logic and self-reliance to give them hope and inner calm. We pray too for those without compassion who are trapped in a pandemic but only care for their own needs, desires, prestige, and power, and see it as an opportunity for wealth and gain. We pray for those in fear, scared by what they know and don't know. We pray that they and all people feel your love wrapped around us like a fleece blanket on a cool night. Feel your love deep within us like a scintillating diamond, hard and pure. Feel your love guide us like a lighthouse, warning of danger and shining us onto safe harbor, which is you. You who are our God. You who have called us yours. You to whom we pray. Amen. And again I say, be at peace. Go knowing that the Lord your God loves you just as you are, unconditionally in all of your power and magnificence. Go knowing that you are part of all of us. Know that I love you too. And may God watch between you and me when we are apart, one from the other. Amen.